next speaker, who is Mr. Malcolm Smith. Malcolm has been the citrus breeder at Bundaberg Research Station in Queensland, Department of Agriculture and Fisheries since 1998, building a diverse and important citrus collection, developing high turnover breeding populations, and releasing new rootstock and scion varieties for use by Australian growers. He has a keen interest in wild citrus relatives, a highlight being his discovery and description of Citrus awakone, and Malcolm, please correct me, in Papua New Guinea in 2000. International collaboration is essential to effective breeding, and he maintains an extensive network of highly valued industry and science colleagues, and is the Australian delegate on the International Society of Citriculture. His presentation title this afternoon is Breeding with Australian Fingerlimes, More Than Just a Novelty. Thank you for joining us so very early this morning, Malcolm.
Thank you, Ruth. It's a pleasure to be part of this symposium, and I must firstly thank Dr. Dutt for inviting me to be part of it, and also to Jamie and yourself, Ruth, for organising what's been a very smooth session this afternoon. So good afternoon to everybody. I'm going to talk about the work that we're doing in Australia with finger limes. Even though it may not be directly related to commercial production of finger limes, I think we've still got some experiences that commercial growers or even hobbyists of finger limes will find hopefully of interest. So today I'm going to briefly talk, just touch on some of the history of finger lime research in Australia. And then I'll move on to talk about what our current activities are and what the objectives are, some of the outcomes that we've been able to achieve so far. And then I'd also like to sort of sound some words of caution on four aspects, which I think have probably been covered better by other speakers, but I'll still touch on them just to kind of reinforce them. So there's some post-harvest issues, there's obviously cost of production, some fairly significant pest challenges that we certainly experience here anyway. And then there's marketing, which I think the next speaker is going to cover in far more detail than I can. So in terms of the history of finger lime research, we know that Australian horticulturists have been working on finger limes for a very long time. And this drawing here is actually from 1891. It was published in a local newspaper in Australia in 1891. And you can see there that the guy has managed to graft navel orange onto Citrus australasica, the finger lime. And so we can be fairly certain that certainly in the later part of the 1800s, people were very interested in finger limes and the role that they could play in sort of conventional citrus production. So I guess the message I want to get across is that finger limes are not something new. It's something that horticulturists have been interested in for a very long time. But the important point, I think, is that, you know, we've had, you know, probably over 130 years of sort of sporadic experimentation with finger limes, the species that are both from Australia and from Papua New Guinea. And in reality, they haven't yet contributed anything useful to commercial citriculture. So I always keep that as a thing in the back of my mind, that we can work on things that might seem interesting, but we really haven't moved to the position of them being contributing useful, not to conventional citrus culture anyway. The other historical thing that I'll add in here, because David Karp mentioned it in his excellent talk earlier on this afternoon, and that's a guy called Bill Montgomery, and you might have recalled that a guy by the name of Montgomery had contributed the Citrus australasica, or the Microcitrus australasica, that's held in the Californian collection at Riverside and is the main cultivar used in California. So this is the actual guy himself, and I managed to interview him a few years ago because he's worked in our department back in the 1950s, and he had some fascinating history about the citrus work that he was doing back then, and he was obviously contributing to germplasm collections around the world. So our department has a long history of helping to distribute these species, particularly back when it used to be easier to do. And Bill here was sort of a key part of that back in the 1950s. But we also have records of the species being distributed worldwide back in the 1800s as well. So again, the species, the finger limes, have been well and truly distributed around the world. It's not something new in terms of distribution. I'm looking pretty happy there because this guy was pretty funny to interview. He had some pretty amazing stories about his work in citrus back in the 1950s. Okay, so in terms of our current work, our work's based at Bundaberg Research Station, and we have all of these finger lime or native microcitrus species, formerly microcitrus species, in our collection here. So you can see that we have the six species that are native or endemic to Australia, and we also have the three species that are endemic to Papua New Guinea. The important point that I want to make here in terms of this symposium is that it's really only Citrus australasica that has any commercial merit in its own right. All these other species, they're of interest perhaps to breeders or to plant collectors, but as a commercial product, really none of those other species have anything going for them. And australasica or Citrus australasica is really quite unique in the commercial appeal that it has in its own right, particularly colours and flavours and shapes. All the other species, you might think, oh, well, australasica is pretty interesting. Perhaps we should take an interest in these other species. I can tell you that if you're interested in australasica, you've picked the best one. There's a huge amount of natural variation, and we've already seen some really good pictures of that, but this is the natural variation. So these are all selections that have been made directly out of the wild, and they're all selections that, again, Judy Viola has made, and her name's come up quite a bit today because she has done some fantastic work with finger limes. So you can see there that even within the wild, there's a lot of stuff going on. And that's some of the natural variation that occurs in the juice vesicles. And the important thing is that here that horticulturists have been making selections from the wild for at least 100 years. So I would suggest that most of the natural variation that exists in this species has probably already been sampled. If there's pretty interesting stuff out there, the chances are that somebody's already propagated and they're trying to grow it commercially. So I would suggest that the future advances in terms of finger limes is going to come from open pollinated seedling populations, which is exactly what we just saw from Robert and Tony in their presentation in California, and also from controlled crosses, as we saw from Angel Dutt and some of the work in Florida. So I don't think there's a lot to be gained probably from trying to sample from the wild much more, but to use some of the better material that's already been selected and to use that in a conventional breeding program, whether that be open pollinated or controlled crosses. In terms of our work here in Australia, we're not actually breeding finger limes. We're using them as a parent for other traits. So we're trying to use finger limes for breeding new cyan varieties and also for breeding new rootstock varieties. We're not using them to breed new finger lime varieties. Again, Manjul touched on this issue, and this is a very significant issue with the native citrus, not just australasica, but some of the other species, in terms of breeding, using them as rootstocks or trying to breed rootstocks using the Citrus australasica or even Citrus australis. And that is that they are extremely sensitive to Tristeza virus. They're fine if you grow them as a cyan, you don't get any Tristeza symptoms or you don't get too many Tristeza symptoms. But as soon as you try to use them as a rootstock, you'll get very significant problems. And you can possibly see here very severe honeycombing happening in the rootstock and also a lot of ropiness in this example over here. So a major problem with using them as a rootstock breeding program is their susceptibility to Tristeza. So we've been able to tackle this problem over the last sort of 10 or 15 years. And we've used, obviously, trifoliata as a source of virus resistance, and we've hybridized the finger limes with trifoliata to try and capture the resistance gene from trifoliata. And we're starting to see some success with that. So we call them extreme hybrids because we are really crossing stuff that is at the extremes in terms of conventional compatibility. And this tree that you can see there on the right-hand side is Deb standing next to a mandarin tree grafted onto one of our extreme hybrids. And it's a cross that has finger lime as a parent, and it also has trifoliata as a parent. And it also has one of the species from Papua New Guinea as a parent. So a fairly involved crossing program with the main objective of trying to capture virus resistance and then hopefully retain some of the useful rootstock traits that these native citrus might have as well. And it's interesting, that tree there is 4 years old and it's growing very well. And we've got a lot of controls in that experiment, conventional rootstocks. And it's at least as good as some of those conventional rootstocks in terms of its growth pattern. So it's certainly up there. If a commercial grower came to me and said, I want to try this rootstock on a new orchard or a new grove, as you would say, we'd be quite happy for them to try that because we know that it's performing reasonably well. The other thing I'd mention is that this trial, even though we're working in a subtropical climate, we do occasionally get very severe frosts. And this particular rootstock trial was subjected to a very severe frost about 12 months after planting, and we lost a lot of the trees. We probably, the frost probably killed at least a third of the trees in this experiment. And this particular hybrid here, which has finger lime as part of its parentage, that survived quite well. So there was some talk earlier on about cold tolerance. In terms of cold tolerance as a rootstock, I think perhaps the Australasica as a parent certainly has some potential there, or it certainly doesn't. It's not a limitation in terms of using it in a breeding program. And you can see in that graph down there on the bottom that they're all different hybrids that have Australasica in their parentage. And we're getting some quite large differences in the growth rates of the trees on those Australasica hybrids. All of those individual rootstocks have resistance to Tristeza virus. So we're getting to the point where we have a lot of stuff to select from that we know is resistant to the virus. And then we can select for, you know, its growth behavior or its fruit quality or cold tolerance or whatever else. So we're starting to get a reasonable population coming through to select from. The other use that we're making of finger lime is in scion breeding. And we're mainly using it to try and capture the ruby gene or the red flesh anthocyanin, and that's obviously present in some varieties of finger lime. So the main parent that we're using here is this 18QO61. That's a native selection. So that's a straight Australasica. And we've hybridized that with some of the mandarins out of our breeding program, as well as some commercial varieties like Daisy. And you can see here something like this 20Q112 is an F1 hybrid that results from that cross. And you can see that we've been able to capture the ruby trait in the F1. And also it's in this one here, 20Q109. But importantly, it segregates. So you do get a lot of hybrids that they might look a little bit like a finger lime, but they don't have the ruby trait. So we have to be very careful about what we choose as our initial parent if we're going to capture that trait. The other important point I'd make about finger limes, in terms of what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to get away from something that looks like a finger lime, whereas finger lime growers may well find that you know, brick crossing with some of these conventional citruses is a good way to go, because you do end up with F1 hybrids that are very much like finger limes. They're certainly far more like finger limes than they are with mandarin. So even though, you know, something like this hybrid here and this hybrid here have mandarin as half their parentage, they're certainly, in terms of appearance, far more like finger limes than they are like mandarins. The other thing that is obviously of interest, and this has sort of been really nice because it's we were doing our work with the native citrus sort of on the side. We didn't try to make too much noise about it because it wasn't something that was seen as being a high priority by the industry or by the funding bodies up until very, very recently. And that's largely as a result of the work that's come out of the United States in the last sort of decade or so, showing that they seem to have some useful characteristics in terms of dealing with this horrible Wonglong Bing problem. So it's been quite heartening for us that the work that we've been doing for such a long period of time is sort of suddenly taking on a bit more steam, because people are saying, well, maybe it's not such a stupid idea after all, and maybe there is some merit in using these wild species in a program designed to breed conventional mandarins and oranges. And in this example here, this is another native species that people would be familiar with, the Australian desert lime, which occurs sort of more in the inland areas on the eastern side of Australia. And we've been using that for quite a few years, mainly for rootstock breeding, because we just imagine that it must have some good salt tolerance and possibly some good cold tolerance as well. And it has been used in the past by international breeders for cold tolerance. But we've been increasingly using it for cyan breeding now as well to presumably capture some of the Wonglong Bing resistance that is purported to be contained within this species. So again, it's very heartening to have some material, some fairly advanced material that we can continue to cross with, and to perhaps not to have to try and do that kind of work under the radar like we've had to do in the past. I'll just touch on some of those words of caution. And this is the first one, and I'm not sure whether people have seen this problem internationally, but we've found that Citrus australasica is extremely susceptible to longicorn damage. And it took us a long time to work out what this problem was, because particularly, say, for example, in this middle one here, a lot of people would just look at that and say, oh, that's Phytophthora in citrus, which is, you know, pretty classic symptoms. Excuse me. But in actual fact, it's a longicorn beetle that is burrowing underneath the bark and causing these kind of symptoms. And this one on the left-hand side here makes it more obvious here, because you can see where the insect has got underneath the bark and burrowed up. Now, this is a devastating problem in australasica. It will absolutely kill the trees. And so anyone who's growing finger limes in Australia, I always say to them, look, for goodness sake, make sure you manage this problem. Otherwise, you won't have any finger lime trees in 4 or 5 years. So not sure whether this is a problem internationally, but I would certainly be on the lookout for symptoms that you might think are Phytophthora, because I would say if you have finger limes with Phytophthora symptoms, it's far more likely that it's going to be longicorns that are causing the damage. And that's an example there of one of the larvae that we've dug out of one of our dead finger limes trees. We took way too long to work out what this problem was, and by that time we'd already lost a lot of our collection of finger limes here at the research station, which was very disappointing. The other thing that I'll touch on is some post-harvest issues, and I'm sure growers have experienced this already. There are some varieties that develop a problem that I guess is very similar to oleocellulosis, and it may be exactly the same thing, where after harvest, the skin of the fruit develops sort of brown necrosis. That can be a very significant problem on some varieties. And so I'd really urge people that if you are planting or looking to plant new varieties, just try and make sure you've got information on what they're like in terms of their post-harvest performance, because that'll be a major problem if you're trying to sell fresh fruit, and particularly if you've got long shipping times on any of that. And then, of course, I've mentioned costs of production and marketing. It's obviously a very small fruit. It's very thorny. It's very expensive to harvest. And we've had examples here where growers have sort of picked a half-ton bin of fruit, and, you know, it's cost them an absolute fortune in terms of labour to harvest that fruit, and then not being able to sell that fruit because market wasn't able to handle that amount of fruit. So you've got issues around costs of production, particularly costs of harvesting, and then you've got issues around marketing in terms of, you know, what the size of the market window actually is. And without wanting to sound really negative, I must say that I haven't met anyone yet who's got rich growing finger limes. So do keep that in mind as well. And I'll leave it there, Ruth. So just there's some of the funding bodies that fund our work here, and some of the growers. All of our trial work, particularly with rootstocks, is done on commercial farms or commercial groves, and they're some of the people that help to make that possible. So thank you.